This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The Scramble for Africa was the invasion, occupation, division, colonization and annexation of African territory by European powers during the period of new imperialism, between 1881 and 1914. It is also called the Partition of Africa and the Conquest of Africa in 1870. Only 10% of Africa was under European control. By 1914 it had increased to 90% of the continent, with only Ethiopia, Abyssinia, the Dervish state present-day Somalia and Liberia still being independent. The Berlin Conference of 1884, which regulated European colonization and trade in Africa, is usually referred to as the starting point of the Scramble for Africa. Consequent to the political and economic rivalries among the European empires in the last quarter of the 19th century, the partitioning of Africa was how the Europeans avoided warring amongst themselves over Africa. The latter years of the 19th century saw the transition from informal imperialism, hegemony, by military influence and economic dominance, to the direct rule of a people, which brought about colonial imperialism. Contents 1. Background 2. Causes 21. Africa and global markets 22. Strategic rivalry 221. Germany's Weltpolitik 222. Italy's expansion 3. Crises prior to the First World War 31. Colonization of the Congo 32. Suez Canal 33. Berlin Conference 1884-85-34. Britain's administration of Egypt and South Africa 35. Moroccan Crisis 36. Dervish Resistance 37. Herero Wars and the Maji Maji Rebellion 4. Colonial Encounter 41. Colonial Consciousness and Exhibitions 411. Colonial Lobby 412. Colonial Propaganda and Jingoism 4121. Colonial Exhibitions 42. Countering Disease 5. Colonialism leading to World War I. 6. African colonies listed by colonizing power 61. Belgium 62. France 63. Germany 64. Italy 65. Portugal 66. Russia 67. Spain 68. United Kingdom 69. Independent States 610. Background 611. Petro States 7. See also 8. References 9. Further reading 10. External links. Background. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. May 2011. Learn how and when to remove this template message. David Livingstone, early explorer of the interior of Africa and fighter against the slave trade. The Portuguese were the first post-Middle Ages Europeans to firmly establish settlements, trade posts, permanent fortifications and ports of call along the coast of the African continent. From the beginning of the Age of Discovery, during the 15th century there was little interest in, and less knowledge of, the interior. For some two centuries thereafter European exploration of the African interior began in earnest at the end of the 18th century. By 1835, Europeans had mapped most of northwestern Africa. In the middle decades of the 19th century, the most famous of the European explorers were David Livingstone and H.M. Stanley, both of whom mapped vast areas of southern Africa and central Africa. Arduous expeditions in the 1850s and 1860s by Richard Burton, John Speke and James Grant located the Great Central Lakes and the source of the Nile. By the end of the 19th century, Europeans had charted the Nile from its source, traced the courses of the Niger, Congo and Zambezi rivers, and realized the vast resources of Africa. Even as late as the 1870s, European states still controlled only 10% of the African continent, all their territories being near the coast. The most important holdings were Angola and Mozambique, held by Portugal, the Cape Colony, held by the United Kingdom, and Algeria, held by France. By 1914, only Ethiopia and Liberia were independent of European control. Technological advancement facilitated overseas expansionism. Industrialization brought about rapid advancements in transportation and communication, especially in the forms of steam navigation, railways, and telegraphs. Medical advances also were important, especially medicines for tropical diseases. The development of quinine, an effective treatment for malaria, enabled vast expanses of the tropics to be accessed by Europeans. Causes Africa and global markets. The Rhodes Colossus, an 1892 caricature of Cecil Rhodes after announcing plans for a telegraph line from Cape Town to Cairo for punch, by Edward Linley. Samburn. Sub-Saharan Africa, one of the last regions of the world largely untouched by informal imperialism, was also attractive to Europe's ruling elites for economic, political and social reasons during a time when Britain's balance of trade showed a growing deficit, with shrinking and increasingly protectionist continental markets due to the Long Depression 1873-96, Africa offered Britain, Germany, France, and other countries an open market that would garner them a trade surplus, a market that bought more from the colonial power than it sold overall. In addition, surplus capital was often more profitably invested overseas, where cheap materials, limited competition, and abundant raw materials made a greater premium possible. Another inducement for imperialism arose from the demand for raw materials unavailable in Europe, especially copper, cotton, rubber, palm oil, cocoa, diamonds, tea, and tin, to which European consumers had grown accustomed and upon which European industry had grown dependent. Additionally, Britain wanted the southern and eastern coasts of Africa for stopover ports on the route to Asia and its empire in India. However, in Africa, excluding the area which became the Union of South Africa in 1910, the amount of capital investment by Europeans was relatively small, compared to other continents. Consequently, the companies involved in tropical African commerce were relatively small. Apart from Cecil Rhodes's De Beers Mining Company, Rhodes had carved out Rhodesia for himself, Leopold II of Belgium later, and with considerable brutality, exploited the Congo Free State. These events might detract from the pro-imperialist arguments of colonial lobbies such as the Aldutcher Verband, Francesco Crispi and Jules Ferry, who argued that sheltered overseas markets in Africa would solve the problems of low prices and overproduction caused by shrinking continental markets. John A. Hobson argued in Imperialism that this shrinking of continental markets was a key factor of the global new imperialism period. William Easterly of New York University, however, disagrees with the link made between capitalism and imperialism, arguing that colonialism is used mostly to promote state-led development rather than corporate development. He has stated that imperialism is not so clearly linked to capitalism and free markets. Historically, there has been a closer link between colonialism, imperialism, and state-led approaches to development. Strategic Rivalry. Contemporary illustration of Major Marchand's trek across Africa in 1898. The rivalry between Britain, France, Germany, and the other European powers accounts for a large part of the colonization. While tropical Africa was not a large zone of investment, other overseas regions were the vast interior between the gold and diamond-rich southern Africa and Egypt had strategic value in securing the flow of overseas trade. Britain was under political pressure to secure lucrative markets against encroaching rivals in China and its eastern colonies, most notably India, Malaya, Australia and New Zealand. Thus, securing the key waterway between east and west, the Suez Canal, was crucial. However, the prominent theory proposed by William L. Langer in Imperial Diplomacy 1935, and Ronald Robinson and John Andrew Gallagher in Africa and the Victorians 1961, which suggested that Britain annexed East Africa in the 1880-90s out of geostrategic concerns connected to the Nile Valley and Britain's position in Egypt, and by extension the sea route to India via the Suez Canal, was challenged by John Darwin in 1997, a refutation that was further contextualized and consolidated by Jonas F. Yerso in 2015. Slaves captured from the Congo aboard an Arab slave ship intercepted by the Royal Navy 1869. One of the chief justifications for the colonization of Africa was the suppression of the slave trade. The scramble for African territory also reflected concern for the acquisition of military and naval bases, for strategic purposes and the exercise of power. The growing navies, and new ships driven by steam power, required coaling stations and ports for maintenance. Defense bases were also needed for the protection of sea routes and communication lines, particularly of expensive and vital international waterways such as the Suez Canal. Colonies were also seen as assets in balance of power negotiations, useful as items of exchange at times of international bargaining. Colonies with large native populations were also a source of military power. Britain and France used large numbers of British Indian and North African soldiers, respectively, in many of their colonial wars. In the age of nationalism, there was pressure for a nation to acquire an empire as a status symbol. The idea of greatness became linked with the sense of duty underlying many nations' strategies in the early 1880s. Pierre Savornin de Brazza was exploring the Kingdom of Congo for France, at the same time Henry Morton Stanley explored it in on behalf of Leopold II of Belgium, who would have it as his personal Congo Free State. See section below. France occupied Tunisia in May 1881, which may have convinced Italy to join the German-Austrian dual alliance. In 1882, thus forming the Triple Alliance the same year, Britain occupied Egypt, hitherto an autonomous state owing nominal fealty to the Ottoman Empire, which ruled over Sudan and parts of Chad, Eritrea, and Somalia. In 1884, Germany declared Togoland, the Cameroons and South West Africa to be under its protection, and France occupied Guinea. French West Africa AOF was founded in 1895, and French Equatorial Africa in 1910. Germany's Weltpolitik, the Askari colonial troops in German East Africa. Circa 1906, Germany was hardly a colonial power before the new imperialism period, but would eagerly participate in this race fragmented in various states. Germany was only unified under Prussia's rule after the 1866 Battle of Königgrätz and the 1870 Franco-Prussian War. A rising industrial power close on the heels of Britain, Germany began its world expansion in the 1880s after isolating France by the dual alliance with Austria-Hungary and then the 1882 Triple Alliance with Italy. Chancellor Otto von Bismarck proposed the 1884-85 Berlin Conference, which set the rules of effective control of a foreign territory. Weltpolitik. World policy was the foreign policy adopted by Kaiser Wilhelm II in 1890, with the aim of transforming Germany into a global power through aggressive diplomacy, the acquisition of overseas colonies, and the development of a large navy. Some Germans, claiming themselves of Friedrich List's thought, advocated expansion in the Philippines and Timor. Others proposed to set themselves in Formosa, modern Taiwan, etc. At the end of the 1870s, these isolated voices began to be relayed by a real imperialist policy, backed by mercantilist thesis. In 1881, Hubby Schleiden, a lawyer, published Deutsche Kolonisation, according to which the development of national consciousness demanded an independent overseas policy. Pan-Germanism was thus linked to the young nation's imperialist drives. In the beginning of the 1880s, the Deutscher Kolonialverein was created, and got its own magazine in 1884, the Kolonialzeitung. This colonial lobby was also relayed by the nationalist Alldeutscher Verband generally. Bismarck was opposed to widespread German colonialism, but he had to resign at the insistence of the new German Emperor Wilhelm II on 18 March 1890. Wilhelm II instead adopted a very aggressive policy of colonization and colonial expansion. Germany's expansionism would lead to the Tirpitz Plan, implemented by Admiral von Tirpitz, who would also champion the various fleet acts starting in 1898, thus engaging in an arms race with Britain. By 1914, they had given Germany the second largest naval force in the world, roughly 40% smaller than the Royal Navy, according to von Tirpitz. This aggressive naval policy was supported by the National Liberal Party rather than by the conservatives, implying that imperialism was supported by the rising middle classes. Germany became the third largest colonial power in Africa, nearly all of its overall empire. Of 26 million square kilometers and 14 million colonial subjects in 1914 was found in its African possessions of Southwest Africa, Togoland, the Cameroons, and Tanganyika. Following the 1904 Entente Cordiale between France and the British Empire, Germany tried to isolate France in 1905 with the first Moroccan crisis. This led to the 1905 Algeciras Conference, in which France's influence on Morocco was compensated by the exchange of other territories, and then to the Agadir crisis in 1911, along with the 1898 Fashoda incident between France and Britain. This succession of international crises reveals the bitterness of the struggle between the various imperialist nations, which ultimately led to World War I. Italy's expansion. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. October 2015. Learn how and when to remove this template message. This scene from an Ethiopian painting depicts the Ethiopian triumph against Italian forces at the Battle of Adwa. The Italo-Ethiopian War of 1895-96 distinguished Ethiopia as the only African state to maintain independence in the 19th century, with a decisive show of force. The conquest of Ethiopia, which had remained the last African independent territory, occurred in the Second Italo-Ethiopian War in 1935-36. Italy took possession of parts of Eritrea in 1870 and 1882 following its defeat in the First Italo-Ethiopian War 1895-1896, it acquired Italian Somaliland in 1889-90 and the whole of Eritrea 1899. In 1911, it engaged in a war with the Ottoman Empire, in which it acquired Tripolitania and Cyrenaica, modern Libya. In 1919, Enrico Corradini, who fully supported the war, and later merged his group in the early fascist party PNF, IMF, developed the concept of proletarian nationalism, supposed to legitimize Italy's imperialism by a mixture of socialism with nationalism. We must start by recognizing the fact that there are proletarian nations as well as proletarian classes, that is to say, there are nations whose living conditions are subject to the way of life of other nations. Just as classes are, once this is realized, nationalism must insist firmly on this truth. Italy is, materially and morally, a proletarian nation. The Second Italo-Abyssinian War 1935-36, ordered by the fascist Benito Mussolini, would actually be one of the last colonial wars that is, intended to colonize a foreign country, as opposed to wars of national liberation, occupying Ethiopia, which had remained the last independent African territory, apart from Liberia crises prior to the First World War colonization of the Congo. Henry Morton Stanley. David Livingstone's explorations, carried on by Henry Morton Stanley, excited imaginations with Stanley's grandiose ideas for colonization, but these found little support owing to the problems and scale of action required, except from Leopold II of Belgium, who in 1876 had organized the International African Association, the Congo Society, from 1869 to 1874. Stanley was secretly sent by Leopold II to the Congo region, where he made treaties with several African chiefs along the Congo River, and by 1882 had sufficient territory to form the basis of the Congo Free State. Leopold II personally owned the colony from 1885 and used it as a source of ivory and rubber. Pierre Savornin de Brazza, in his version of Native Dress, photographed by Felix Nadar while Stanley was exploring Congo on behalf of Leopold II of Belgium, the Franco-Italian Marine officer Pierre de Brazza traveled into the western Congo basin and raised the French flag over the newly founded Brazzaville in 1881, thus occupying today's Republic of the Congo. Portugal, which also claimed the area due to old treaties with the native Congo Empire, made a treaty with Britain on 26 February 1884 to block off the Congo Society's access to the Atlantic. By 1890, the Congo Free State had consolidated its control of its territory between Leopoldville and Stanleyville, and was looking to push south down the Lualaba River from Stanleyville. At the same time, the British South Africa Company of Cecil Rhodes was expanding north from the Limpopo River, sending the pioneer column guided by Frederick Selu through Matabeleland, and starting a colony in Mashonaland to the west. In the land where their expansions would meet, was Katanga, site of the Yeke Kingdom of Msiri. Msiri was the most militarily powerful ruler in the area, and traded large quantities of copper, ivory and slaves, and rumors of gold reached European ears. The scramble for Katanga was a prime example of the period. Rhodes and the BSAC sent two expeditions to Msiri in 1890, led by Alfred Sharp, who was rebuffed, and Joseph Thompson, who failed to reach Katanga. Leopold sent four CFS expeditions. First, the La Marinelle expedition could only extract a vaguely worded letter. The Delcommune expedition was rebuffed. The well-armed Stairs expedition was given orders to take Katanga with or without Msiri's consent. Msiri refused, was shot, and the expedition cut off his head and stuck it on a pole as a barbaric lesson to the people. The Bia expedition finished the job of establishing an administration of sorts and a police presence in Katanga. Native Congo Free State laborers who failed to meet rubber collection quotas were often punished by having their hands cut off. Thus, the 500,000 square kilometers of Katanga came into Leopold's possession and brought his African realm up to 2,300,000 square kilometers, 890,000 people, including mass killings and forced labor, that Belgium, under pressure from the Congo Reform Association, ended Leopold II's rule and annexed it in 1908 as a colony of Belgium, known as the Belgian Congo. A hard-hitting 1906 Punch cartoon depicting King Leopold II of Belgium as a rubber vine and snake entangling a Congolese man. King Leopold II of Belgium's brutality in his former colony of the Congo Free State, now the Democratic Republic of the Congo, was well documented. Up to 8 million of the estimated 16 million native inhabitants died between 1885 and 1908, according to the former British diplomat Roger Casement. This depopulation had four main causes: indiscriminate war, starvation, reduction of births and diseases. Sleeping sickness ravaged the country and must also be taken into account for the dramatic decrease in population. It has been estimated that sleeping sickness and smallpox killed nearly half the population in the areas surrounding the lower Congo River. Estimates of the total total death toll vary considerably as the first census did not take place until 1924. It is difficult to quantify the population loss of the period. Casement's report set it at 3 million. William Rubinstein wrote, "More basically, it appears almost certain that the population figures given by Hochschild are inaccurate. There is, of course, no way of ascertaining the population of the Congo before the 20th century, and estimates like 20. Million are purely guesses. Most of the interior of the Congo was literally unexplored, if not inaccessible." See Congo Free State for further details, including numbers of victims. A similar situation occurred in the neighboring French Congo. Most of the resource extraction was run by concession companies, whose brutal methods, along with the introduction of disease, resulted in the loss of up to 50% of the indigenous population. The French government appointed a commission, headed by de Brazza, in 1905 to investigate the rumored abuses in the colony. However, de Brazza died on the return trip, and his searingly critical report was neither acted upon nor released to the public in the 1920s. About 20,000 forced laborers died building a railroad through the French territory. Suez Canal. Main article: Suez Canal port. Said entrance to Suez Canal, showing de Lesseps' statue. French diplomat Ferdinand de Lesseps had obtained many concessions from Ismail Pasha, the Khedive of Egypt and Sudan, in 1854-56, to build the Suez Canal. Some sources estimate the workforce at 30,000, but others estimate that 120,000 workers died over the 10 years of construction due to malnutrition, fatigue and disease, especially cholera. Shortly before its completion in 1869, Khedive Ismail borrowed enormous sums from British and French bankers at high rates of interest. By 1875, he was facing financial difficulties and was forced to sell his block of shares in the Suez Canal. The shares were snapped up by Britain, under its Prime Minister, Benjamin Disraeli, who sought to give his country practical control in the management of this strategic waterway. When Ismail repudiated Egypt's foreign debt in 1879, Britain and France seized joint financial control over the country, forcing the Egyptian ruler to abdicate, and installing his eldest son Taufik Pasha in his place. The Egyptian and Sudanese ruling classes did not relish foreign intervention during the 1870s. European initiatives against the slave trade caused an economic crisis in northern Sudan, precipitating the rise of Mahdist forces in 1881. The Mahdist revolt erupted in Sudan under Muhammad Ahmad, severing Taufik's authority in Sudan the same year. Taufik suffered an even more perilous rebellion by his own Egyptian army in the form of the Arabi Revolt in 1882. Taufik appealed for direct British military assistance, commencing Britain's administration of Egypt. A joint British-Egyptian military force ultimately defeated the Mahdist forces in Sudan in 1898. Thereafter, Britain rather than Egypt seized effective control of Sudan. Berlin Conference 1884-85. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. July 2013. Learn how and when to remove this template. Message. Main article: Berlin Conference. The occupation of Egypt, and the acquisition of the Congo were the first major moves in what came to be a precipitous scramble for African territory in 1884. Otto von Bismarck convened the 1884-85 Berlin Conference to discuss the African problem. The diplomats put on a humanitarian facade by condemning the slave trade, prohibiting the sale of alcoholic beverages and firearms in certain regions, and by expressing concern for missionary activities. More importantly, the diplomats in Berlin laid down the rules of competition by which the great powers were to be guided in seeking colonies. They also agreed that the area along the Congo River was to be administered by Leopold II of Belgium as a neutral area, known as the Congo Free State, in which trade and navigation were to be free. No nation was to stake claims in Africa without notifying other powers of its intentions. No territory could be formally claimed prior to being effectively occupied. However, the competitors ignored the rules when convenient, and on several occasions war was only narrowly avoided. According to Hist 1112F 2013 WordPress.com. Britain's administration of Egypt and South Africa. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. April 2011. Learn how and when to remove This template message, the Mahdist War, was fought between a radical group of Muslim dervishes called Mahdists, who had overrun much of Sudan, and the British forces Boer Child in a British concentration camp during the Second Boer War 1899-1902. Britain's administration of Egypt and the Cape Colony contributed to a preoccupation over securing the source of the Nile River. Egypt was overrun by British forces in 1882, although not formally declared a protectorate until 1914, and never an actual colony. Sudan, Nigeria, Kenya and Uganda were subjugated in the 1890s and early 20th century, and in the south, the Cape Colony, first acquired in 1795, provided a base for the subjugation of neighboring African states and the Dutch Afrikaner settlers who had left the Cape to avoid the British and then founded their own republics in 1877. Theophilus Shepstone annexed the South African Republic or Transvaal, independent from 1857 to 1877 for the British Empire in 1879. After the Anglo-Zulu War, Britain consolidated its control of most of the territories of South Africa. The Boers protested, and in December 1880 they revolted, leading to the First Boer War 1880-81. British Prime Minister William Gladstone signed a peace treaty on 23 March 1881, giving self-government to the Boers in the Transvaal. The Jameson Raid of 1895 was a failed attempt by the British South Africa Company and the Johannesburg Reform Committee to overthrow the Boer government in the Transvaal. The Second Boer War, fought between 1899 and 1902, was about control of the gold and diamond industries. The independent Boer republics of the Orange Free State and the South African Republic or Transvaal were this time defeated and absorbed into the British Empire. The French thrust into the African interior was mainly from the coasts of West Africa, modern-day Senegal, eastward, through the Sahel along the southern border of the Sahara, a huge desert covering most of present-day Senegal, Mali, Niger, and Chad. Their ultimate aim was to have an uninterrupted colonial empire from the Niger River to the Nile, thus controlling all trade to and from the Sahel region. By virtue of their existing control over the caravan routes through the Sahara, the British, on the other hand, wanted to link their possessions in southern Africa, modern South Africa, Botswana, Zimbabwe, Lesotho, Swaziland, and Zambia, with their territories in East Africa, modern Kenya, and these two areas with the Nile Basin. The Sudan, which in those days included most of present-day Uganda, was the key to the fulfillment of these ambitions, especially since Egypt was already under British control. This red line through Africa is made most famous by Cecil Rhodes, along with Lord Milner, the British colonial minister in South Africa. Rhodes advocated such a Cape to Cairo empire, linking the Suez Canal to the mineral-rich southern part of the continent by rail, though hampered by German occupation of Tanganyika until the end of the First World War. Rhodes successfully lobbied on behalf of such a sprawling African empire. If one draws a line from Cape Town to Cairo, Rhodes's dream, and one from Dakar to the Horn of Africa, now Ethiopia, Eritrea, Djibouti and Somalia, the French ambition, these two lines intersect somewhere in eastern Sudan near Fashoda, explaining its strategic importance. In short, Britain had sought to extend its East African empire contiguously from Cairo to the Cape of Good Hope, while France had sought to extend its own holdings from Dakar to the Sudan, which would enable its empire to span the entire continent from the Atlantic Ocean to the Red Sea. A French force under Jean-Baptiste Marchand arrived first at the strategically located fort at Fashoda, soon followed by a British force under Lord Kitchener, commander-in-chief of the British Army since 1892. The French withdrew after a standoff and continued to press claims to other posts in the region. In March 1899, the French and British agreed that the source of the Nile and Congo rivers should mark the frontier between their spheres of influence. Citation needed. Moroccan Crisis. Main articles: First Moroccan Crisis and Second Moroccan Crisis. The Moroccan Sultan Abdelhafid, who led the resistance to French expansionism during the Agadir Crisis, although the 1884-85 Berlin Conference had set the rules for the scramble for Africa, it had not weakened the rival imperialists. The 1898 Fashoda incident, which had seen France and the British Empire on the brink of war, ultimately led to the signature of the Entente Cordiale of 1904, which countered the influence of the European powers of the Triple Alliance. As a result, the new German Empire decided to test the solidity of such influence, using the contested territory of Morocco as a battlefield. Thus, on 31 March 1905, Kaiser Wilhelm II visited Tangiers and made a speech in favor of Moroccan independence, challenging French influence in Morocco. France's influence in Morocco had had been reaffirmed by Britain and Spain in 1904. The Kaiser's speech bolstered French nationalism, and with British support, the French Foreign Minister, Théophile Delcasse, took a defiant line. The crisis peaked in mid-June 1905, when Delcasse was forced out of the ministry by the more conciliation-minded Premier Maurice Rouvier, but by July 1905 Germany was becoming isolated and the French agreed to a conference to solve the crisis. Both France and Germany continued to posture up until the conference, with Germany mobilizing reserve army units in late December and France actually moving troops to the border in January 1906. The 1906 Algeciras Conference was called to settle the dispute of the 13 nations present. The German representatives found their only supporter was Austria-Hungary. France had firm support from Britain, Russia, Italy, Spain, and the US. The Germans eventually accepted an agreement, signed on 31 May 1906, where France yielded certain domestic changes in Morocco but retained control of key areas. However, 5 years later the Second Moroccan Crisis or Agadir Crisis was sparked by the deployment of the German gunboat Panther, to the port of Agadir on 1 July 1911. Germany had started to attempt to surpass Britain's naval supremacy. The British Navy had a policy of remaining larger than the next two naval fleets in the world combined. When the British heard of the Panther's arrival in Morocco, they wrongly believed that the Germans meant to turn Agadir into a naval base on the Atlantic. The German move was aimed at reinforcing claims for compensation for acceptance of effective French control of the North African Kingdom, where France's pre-eminence had been upheld by the 1906 Algeciras Conference. In November 1911 a convention was signed under which Germany accepted France's position in Morocco in return for territory in the French Equatorial African colony of Middle Congo, now the Republic of the Congo. France and Spain subsequently established a full protectorate over Morocco 30 March 1912, ending what remained of the country's formal independence. Furthermore, British backing for France during the two Moroccan crises reinforced the entente between the two countries and added to Anglo-German estrangement, deepening the divisions that would culminate in World War I. Statue of Sayyid Mohammed Abdullah Hassan, the Mad Mullah, who led a 20-year-long anti-imperial resistance war. Dervish resistance following the Berlin Conference at the end of the 19th century. The British, Italians, and Ethiopians sought to claim lands owned by the Somalis, such as the Warsingali Sultanate, the Ajuran Sultanate, and the Gobroon Dynasty. The Dervish state was a state established by Muhammad Abdullah Hassan, a Somali religious leader who gathered Muslim soldiers from across the Horn of Africa and united them into a loyal army known as the Dervishes. This Dervish army enabled Hassan to carve out a powerful state through conquest of land sought after by the Ethiopians and the European powers. The Dervish state successfully repulsed the British Empire 4 times and forced it to retreat to the coastal region. Due to these successful expeditions, the Dervish state was recognized as an ally by the Ottoman and German empires. The Turks also named Hassan Emir of the Somali nation, and the Germans promised to officially recognize any territories the Dervishes were to acquire after a quarter of a century of holding the British at bay. The Dervishes were finally defeated in 1920 as a direct consequence of Britain's use of aircraft. Herero Wars and the Maji Maji Rebellion. Main articles: Herero Wars and Maji Maji Rebellion. During the period from 1904 to 1908, Germany's colonies in German Southwest Africa and German East Africa were rocked by separate, contemporaneous native revolts against their rule in both territories. The threat to German rule was quickly defeated once large-scale reinforcements from Germany arrived, with the Herero rebels in German Southwest Africa being defeated at the Battle of Waterberg and the Maji Maji rebels in German East Africa being steadily crushed by German forces slowly advancing through the countryside, with the natives resorting to guerrilla warfare. German efforts to clear the bush of civilians in German Southwest Africa then resulted in a genocide of the population surviving Herero, emaciated, after their escape through the Omaheke Desert. In total, as many as 65,000 Herero, 80% of the total Herero population, and 10,000 Namaqua, 50% of the total Namaqua population, either starved, died of thirst, or were worked to death in camps such as Shark Island concentration camp. Between 1904 and 1908, characteristic of this genocide was death by starvation and the poisoning of the population's wells whilst they were trapped in the Namib Desert. Colonial encounter, colonial consciousness and exhibitions. Pygmies and a European. Some pygmies would be exposed in human zoos, such as Oda Benga, displayed by eugenicist Madison Grant in the Bronx Zoo colonial lobby. In its earlier stages, imperialism was generally the act of individual explorers as well as some adventurous merchantmen. The colonial powers were a long way from approving without any dissent the expensive adventures carried out abroad. Various important political leaders such as Gladstone opposed colonization in its first years, however. During his second premiership in 1880–1885 he could not resist the colonial lobby in his cabinet, and thus did not execute his electoral promise to disengage from Egypt. Although Gladstone was personally opposed to imperialism, the social tensions caused by the Long Depression pushed him to favor jingoism. The imperialists had become the parasites of patriotism. Hobson in France, then radical politician Georges Clemenceau also adamantly opposed himself to it. He thought colonization was a diversion from the blue line of the Vosges mountains, that is revanchism and the patriotic urge to reclaim the Alsace-Lorraine region which had been annexed by the German Empire with the 1871 Treaty of Frankfurt. Clemenceau actually made Jules Ferry's cabinet fall after the 1885 Tonkin disaster. According to Hannah Arendt in The Origins of Totalitarianism 1951, this expansion of national sovereignty on overseas territories contradicted the unity of the nation-state which provided citizenship to its population. Thus, a tension between the universalist will to respect human rights of the colonized people, as they may be considered as citizens of the nation-state, and the imperialist drive to cynically exploit populations deemed inferior began to surface. Some, in colonizing countries, opposed what they saw as unnecessary evils of the colonial administration when left to itself, as described in Joseph Conrad's Heart of Darkness 1899, contemporary of Kipling's The White Man's Burden, or in Louis Ferdinand Céline's Journey to the End of the Night 1932. Colonial lobbies emerged to legitimize the scramble for Africa and other expensive overseas adventures in Germany, France, and Britain. The middle class often sought strong overseas policies to ensure the market's growth even in lesser powers. Voices like Enrico Corradini claimed a place in the Sun for so-called proletarian nations, bolstering nationalism and militarism in an early prototype of fascism. Colonial propaganda and jingoism. Colonial exhibitions. This section needs additional citations for verification. Please help improve this article by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. September 2011. Learn how and when to remove this template message poster for the 1906 colonial exhibition in Marseille, France. However, by the end of World War I, the colonial empires had become very popular almost everywhere in Europe. Public opinion had been convinced of the needs of a colonial empire, although most of the metropolitans would never see a piece of it. Colonial exhibitions had been instrumental in this change of popular mentalities brought about by the colonial propaganda, supported by the colonial lobby and by various scientists. Thus, the conquest of territories were inevitably followed by public displays of the indigenous people for scientific and leisure purposes. Karl Hagenbeck, a German merchant in wild animals and a future entrepreneur of most Europeans' zoos, thus decided in 1874 to exhibit Samoa and Sami people as purely natural populations. In 1876, he sent one of his collaborators to the newly conquered Egyptian Sudan to bring back some wild beasts and Nubians presented in Paris, London, and Berlin. These Nubians were very successful. Such human zoos could be found in Hamburg, Antwerp, Barcelona, London, Milan, New York City, Warsaw, etc., with 200,000 to 300,000 visitors attending each exhibition. Tuaregs were exhibited after the French conquest of Timbuktu, visited by René Caillié, disguised as a Muslim, in 1828, thereby winning the prize offered by the French Société de Géographie, Malagasy after the occupation of Madagascar, Amazons of Abomey after Bahanzin's mediatic defeat against the French in 1894. Not used to the climatic conditions, some of the indigenous exposed died, such as some Galibis in Paris in 1892. Geoffroy de Saint-Hilaire, director of the Parisian Jardin d'Acclimatation, decided in 1877 to organize two ethnological spectacles, presenting Nubians and Inuit. The public of the Jardin d'Acclimatation doubled, with 1 million paying entrances that year, a huge success for these times. Between 1877 and 1912, approximately 30 ethnological exhibitions were presented at the Jardin Zoologique d'Acclimatation. Negro villages would be presented in Paris's 1878 and 1879 World's Fair. The 1900 World's Fair presented the famous diorama Living in Madagascar, while the colonial exhibitions in Marseille 1906 and 1922 and in Paris 1907 and 1931 would also display human beings in cages, often nudes or quasi-nudes. Nomadic Senegalese villages were also created, thus displaying the power of the colonial Empire to all the population in the U.S., Madison Grant, head of the New York Zoological Society, exposed pygmy Ota Benga in the Bronx Zoo alongside the apes and others in 1906 at the behest of Grant, a prominent scientific racist and eugenicist. Zoo director Hornaday placed Ota Benga in a cage with an orangutan and labeled him the missing link in an attempt to illustrate Darwinism, and in particular that Africans like Ota Benga are closer to apes than were Europeans. Other colonial exhibitions included the 1924 British Empire Exhibition and the successful 1931 Paris Exposition Coloniale, countering disease from the beginning of the 20th century onward. The elimination or control of disease in tropical countries became a driving force for all colonial powers. The sleeping sickness epidemic in Africa was arrested due to mobile teams systematically screening millions of people at risk in the 20th century. Africa saw the biggest increase in its population due to lessening of the mortality rate in many countries due to peace, famine relief, and medicine. Africa's population has grown from 120 million in 1900 to over 1 billion today. Colonialism leading to World War I. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. April 2011. Learn how and when to remove this template message. German Cameroon. Painting by R. Helgrue, 1908. During the new imperialism period, by the end of the 19th century, Europe added almost 9 million square miles. 23 million. Scramble for Africa, reflecting its advantageous position at its inception in terms of surface area occupied. The French were the marginal victors, but much of their territory consisted of the sparsely populated Sahara. The political imperialism followed the economic expansion, with the colonial lobbies bolstering chauvinism and jingoism at each crisis in order to legitimize the colonial enterprise. The tensions between the imperial powers led to a succession of crises, which finally exploded in August 1914, when previous rivalries and alliances created a domino situation that drew the major European nations into the First World War. Austria-Hungary attacked Serbia to avenge the murder by Serbian agents of Austrian Crown Prince Francis Ferdinand. Russia would mobilize to assist Allied Serbia. Germany would intervene to support Austria-Hungary against Russia, since Russia had a military alliance with France against Germany. The German General Staff, led by General von Moltke, decided to realize the well-prepared Schlieffen Plan to invade and quickly knock France out of the war before turning against Russia in what was expected to be a long campaign. This required an invasion of Belgium, which brought Britain into the war against Germany. Austria-Hungary and their allies. German U-boat campaigns against ships bound for Britain eventually drew the United States into what had become World War I. Moreover, using the Anglo-Japanese alliance as an excuse, Japan leapt onto this opportunity to conquer German interests in China and the Pacific to become the dominating power in the Western Pacific, setting the stage for the Second Sino-Japanese War starting in 1937 and eventually World War II. African colonies listed by colonizing power. Belgium Force Publique. Soldiers in the Belgian Congo at its peak, the FP had 19,000 African soldiers, led by 420 white officers. Congo Free State and Belgian Congo. Today's Democratic Republic of the Congo. Rwanda. Urundi, comprising modern Rwanda and Burundi, 1922-62. France. Further information, list of French possessions and colony section. Ivory Coast. Niger. French. Upper Volta. Now Burkina Faso. French. Dahomey. Now Benin. French. Togoland. 1916-60, now Togo. French. Equatorial Africa. 1876-1882. French. East Africa. Italy. Italian Libya. Italian Eritrea. Italian Somaliland. Later, during the interwar period, with the Second Italo-Ethiopian War, Italy would annex Ethiopia, which formed together with Eritrea and Italian Somaliland the Italian East Africa. Aoi, Africa Orientale. Italiana, also defined by the fascist government as Lampero. Portugal. Portuguese West Africa. Now Angola. Mainland Angola. Portuguese Congo. Now Cabinda. Province of Angola. Portuguese East Africa. Now Mozambique. Portuguese Guinea. Now Guinea-Bissau. Portuguese Cape Verde. Portuguese São Tomé and Príncipe. São Tomé Island. Príncipe Island. Fort of São João Baptista de Ayuda. Now Ouida, in Benin. Russia. Sagalo. Now Djibouti. 1889. Spain. Spanish North Africa. Northern Spanish Morocco. Chef Shouan. Shouan Jabela. Yabala. Kurt Lucas. Lucas Riff. Spanish West Africa. Southern Spanish Morocco. Cape Juby. IFNI Spanish Sahara now Western Sahara Rio de Oro Saguia El Hamra Spanish Guinea now Equatorial Guinea Fernando Po Rio Muni Annobon United Kingdom opening of the railway in Rhodesia, 1899 The British were primarily interested in maintaining secure communication lines to India, which led to initial interest in Egypt and South Africa once these two areas were secure. It was the intent of British colonialists such as Cecil Rhodes to establish a Cape Cairo railway and to exploit mineral and agricultural resources. Control of the Nile was viewed as a strategic and commercial advantage. Egypt. Anglo-Egyptian Sudan 1899-1956. British Somaliland now part of Somalia. British East Africa. Kenya Colony. Uganda Protectorate. Tanzania. Orange River Colony. Southwest Africa from 1915, now Namibia. British West Africa. Gambia Colony and Protectorate. Sierra Leone. Nigeria. British Togoland 1916-56, today part of Ghana. Cameroons 1922-61, now parts of Cameroon and Nigeria. Gold Coast. British Colony now Ghana. Nyasaland now Malawi. Basutoland now Lesotho. Swaziland. Independent States. Liberia was the only nation in Africa that was a colony and a protectorate of the United States. Liberia was founded, colonized, established, and controlled by the American Colonization Society, which was a private organization establishment in order to relocate freed African American and Caribbean slaves from the United States and the Caribbean islands in 1821. Liberia declared its independence from the American Colonization Society on July 26, 1847.